What makes a computer a computer? What allows a computer to solve a complicated problem, but a calculator cannot? What is programming? These questions cannot be answered without understanding the hardware. From this video, we will derive the necessary computer structure needed. It will help us understand why it makes sense to build computers this way. The following series of videos are based on Scott's CPU from an excellent book, but how do we know? Please subscribe to be notified. We will start with the two complement method from last time. It's about doing subtraction using addition by breaking down into three steps. It has a key feature of a complex problem, multi-step. Being multi-step means results from previous steps are inputs for the next step. So in the simple circuit we built, adders and inverter are arranged in a particular sequence, making sure that the steps are carried out in the right order. But the circuit is of limited use. The computing modules are pre-arranged to take the right inputs, so they are not reusable for other computations. Hence, we need a more flexible way for input connection. This leads to the first key component we will talk about in this video, bus. No matter what the problem is, users' inputs are stored in memory units as electricity. For example, NetLedge is used to store 1 bit. For more details about how they work, please refer to previous video listed in description. But 1 unit can only represent 2 numbers. To be useful, we need a few of them. Say here, packing 8 together to make 1 byte. Now these 8 bits are viewed as a single unit, so only 1 control is needed, broadcasted to each unit. Turn it on, 1 byte flows in. Turn it off. Data will stay so that user's input can go away. A few initial inputs can be set this way to be computed by the arithmetic logic unit of the CPU. The ALU has different computing modules we'll see later. It can take 2 inputs, spitting 1 output. Each input needs to be wired to the ALU to get computed. Since everyone will go to the same place, it's better to share a public route. Inputs can also go to ALU's other side, so we connect these two. Zooming into the memory, all the output wires are connected to the ALU's input wires. But once everyone is connected to this public route, there will be interferences. Let's see why there will be interferences. The memory unit is made of logic gates. They are made of transistors, the semiconductor switch with a sandwich structure. Applied a high voltage through the middle, it conducts electricity. With a low voltage, it's an insulator. By arranging them in this crisscross structure, we can store 1 bit. High or low voltage, or 1 or 0 if you like. But other units are also connected to this route. They might output the opposite voltage. So this public route is connecting the two ends with voltage difference. Current will flow. These voltages will change once current flow, messing up the data. To avoid this issue, the memory unit cannot output to the public route directly. If we consider from the side of the output wire, it needs to get connected with high or low end in order to output a 1 or 0. But besides that, we need a third possibility, connected to neither end. This can be done if we insert 2 transistors to both ends and output from the middle. Turn off both transistors using the control line. The third state can be chosen. Now the data on the public route cannot reach either end, because the 2 transistors are not conducting. But if you wish to output, the memory unit needs to turn on 1 of the transistors in order to output a 1 or 0. So the 2 output transistors need to be controlled by both the control signal and the memory unit. But there is a hierarchy. Memory unit can turn on the transistor only when the control is on. Therefore, we need AND gates here, allowing memory unit to output only when control is on. To output a high, the upper transistor needs to be turned on, lower one off. So we need an inverter to turn off this lower one. When the output is low, the lower one will swing to conduction while the upper one turns off, outputting a low. When control is off, both will shut off. Memory unit is disconnected. It will not interfere other units. This is called buffer, represented by triangle symbol. All the memory units need these buffers. Users control these buffers through an output button. These output buttons allow users to choose which input to compute. Say we want to compute on these two. We need to let both of them hit in the two sides of the ALU. But the public route can only transport one at a time. Hence, we need a temporary input holder so that we can release them in turn. We will first turn on these two to send and receive electricity, holding the first input towards the ALU. Then let out the second one, striking the other end. How would the ALU do different operations on the inputs? A real ALU like Intel 8085 has 5 basic operations. Believe it or not, they are enough to be put together to do any math operations by programming. Scott's CPU can do 7 things, adding, inverting, shifting right and left, and logic operations, so more than enough. Each module is built separately using gates. We will go through how later. It might be a waste of transistors if compared to a real ALU, because the same gates are built in different modules. But instruction wiring is easy to understand for a beginner. Because all the modules are connected to the inputs, they will spit their own results. All we need is to insert buffers blocking these outputs. Users only need to pick the right one to output. Now, where should the output go? Using the 2's complement example, sometimes they are final, but sometimes they become the inputs for the next step. That's why the output should be allowed back into these memories in order to be computed next time. So the output should be connected to the input route. But this route is busy with the input in order to maintain the computing result. So we need a temporary result holder, storing the result first. Now the input can go away. And the route is clear to transport the output if we turn it on. Now the input side of the memory units need to be wired to the public route in order to accept the result. This public route transporting both input and output is called a bus. It's critical for solving complex problems because they involve series of smaller problems. Results for one problem will be the inputs for the next. So the bus allows the intermediate results to be stored back here, becoming the inputs for the next round. Once we have the ALU and memory units wired this way, performing operations become turning on the memory units in sequence to send and receive electricity. Using 2's complement as an example, here we are manually performing the steps. Invert the subtractor hand, store the inverted result, add 1 to the inverted result to get the complement. Store the complement. Add the minuend to the complement to get the final result. Store the result. We know that computers do things automatically. So we need a sequenced power supply that can turn on these units automatically. This leads to the next topic on automation, by building a sequencer.